Welcome back to Baruto Anime Review, episode number 214. Yes, I do know I was supposed to do this yesterday, but it got late, and I had zero time to watch it. So, I watched it today, right after I did Super Sentai episodes. And this episode is called Predestined Fate. That's the name of the 214th episode of the anime. Adapting from the entirety of chapter 47 and the first 30 pages of chapter number 48. Yes, this arc does not have many chapters left to adapt. Like, as of this episode, they had like less than 10 chapters left. Now, the obvious question is, like, how far are they going to go with adapting this arc? That's a really good question. Because once they get to 58, they pretty much almost caught up with the manga, with what has been released. So my guess is when it gets to that particular point, they're probably going to temporarily stop doing adaptations of the manga and basically go straight back to doing a lot of anime original content until the current arc is over with, whatever the current arc currently is in the manga, because it didn't seem like, I would say the current arc is probably just something for Code to do. Yep. So this episode, let's continue off from last week. Everybody's simply just watching a big battle between Jagan and Kashikojin. And, of course, last week's episode ended with Kashikojin surrounding Jagan with flames. Well, that was until he tries to shrink to get rid of the flames. And then he decided to basically just fully integrate his karma and become Isshin. And basically also seeing before this, before what happens next, we see that possibly that, well, Kawanki, who is a vessel of Isshin, that he might, well, be affected. And of course, there was an option to kill him. Naruto's like, no, we're not going to kill him. And because apparently he knew some stuff about Kawanki to tell him, he basically breaks into the interrogation room and tries to threaten him with his big arm. And Sasuke stops him with his sword. Before I continue here, that is not the original sword that Sasuke had in Naruto Shippuden. Nope, that is actually a replacement sword. And you're probably asking, Nick, how would you know that? I've watched Shippuden. And if you're curious, though, what happened to the original sword? It fell into a pit of lava. Yes, that is seriously what happened to the damn sword. And that happened toward the end of the Fourth Ninja War. And my guess is during, at some point during the time skip, he got a replacement sword, because you see it in the Sasuke arc in the final season of Shippuden, that he's got a new sword. Because the fact that that particular book took place 2 years after the events of the final arc at the, well, it was adapted for the anime, so at that point he must have got a new sword when he was wandering around. And so the second sword he's only had for about 15 years. His original sword, he had that for about 3 years before he lost it. Yep. Of course, Naruto's telling Boruto and Kawanki, I told you not to come in here, but they did anyways. Amano's very happy to see Kawanki, and then we see that Kawanki's acting weird, his karma's acting up, and then it just disappears. According to Amano, the karma got erased. The way he explains it is that there can't be two personalities, two things, the same personality, like two pieces of the same thing. So, despite the fact he's a vessel for Ishii, there can't be, like, more than one had the karma. So, the karma in him got erased. And, in case you're curious, though, in the manga, is it still gone? Yes, it is. Despite the fact that they're trying to bring it back for him, probably not Ishin's per se, probably for a different guy, because they probably need it for some reason. But yeah, the karma is gone. Yes, since his debut, that's always part of his hand. And now, his left hand is perfectly fine. The only time you didn't see that particular mark on his hand was in flashback. In present day, never seen before, because he's always had that particular mark. And then we start to see him basically fully become Isshin Osaki. And, of course, we see Kashikojin's master move, and it's revealed that Kashikojin is a clone of Jiraiya. They also added in the line in the anime that he's one of the legendary Shonin, which that is the true jockey, definitely was. And yeah, he does often look like him, except that his forehead might be a little different. And he does have the same hair. I mean, it was quite obvious this guy was basically Jiraiya. Just by looking at him, just like where the mask is freaking Jiraiya. It was kind of noticeable. It wasn't noticeable in the manga, per se, that much. But it was a little bit more noticeable in the anime. Especially since that a few arcs back, we had Jiraiya actually physically appear in the series. And in case you're curious, though, is there any anime original bits in the series? In this episode? Yes. Yes, there is. There is a brief image of Jiraiya in the episode. That was not from the manga. That brief showing the back of Jiraiya, that was actually complete anime original. That is not from the manga. And of course, they continue their fighting, and then of course he gets pinned down thanks to the pillars. And of course, also his scout toe gets, well, lost. Has to be transported right back because, well, of all this stuff shrinking. And of course, Kashikoji gets pinned by a bunch of pillars. And of course, he thinks, oh yeah, it's over. Like, I think it's be his grave. And that's the episode for you. It's definitely a good episode. What happens next, basically, you'll find next week. Because it looks like that Ishii is going to go to the Hidden Leaf Village next episode. Which is going to start a really big battle. First time we've actually had a big battle in present day, like, the village. I would say this is probably the first time since the Chunin Exam arc that in this series we've actually had a big brawl in the village to this extent. Mm-hmm. Yep. Mostly put just lots of big action this one. It's a big action spectacle, which I think the anime does it really well. Mm-hmm. Nothing really wrong with this episode per se. They do in fact also, like with the transmission lost, Armand puts his glasses back on. I think this actually is anime original. Where he gets the written agreement saying, oh yeah, basically this is perfectly fine. Gets the agreement that him his asylum is granted. And if he has to go outside the village, he has to have permission of both Naruto and Shikamaru. And also that he gets a chance to turn up his tech to, well, Dr. Kishin. So, under his stickers, he gets me under his direct supervision. And Amano has got no problem with that. Because he's a scientist. He does work with our scientists, from what I can tell. The summary basically is told by the doctor not to go in with Bar to go to the staff, basically what happened. And Amano's got no problem with the agreement. Also, they do keep in here, like, that the whole thing of basically the whole thing with the scientific stuff, that's a bit in the original, from what I can tell. But in the case of, like, let me take a look here. Because I don't want to stop at page 30. I think they may have skipped a bit. Let me see here. I'm just trying to check some, just to be sure about this. Must have been a different chapter because, well, that didn't happen this time. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, oh yeah, it's also revealed that Shikamaru is basically, not Shikamaru, Shigidai's collar on his neck. It's not explosive, just ordinary collar. The one that blew the tree branch, that was legit. In the case of the one around Shikamaru's neck, nope, that's not, just an ordinary collar. And it's going to be removed probably a little bit later on because Shigidai's perfectly fine. Yep. I had to bring it up because, well, that's what happened in the episode. So, mostly in the case of Mondo, his little minor role in this particular portion of the arc, it's done. Really, it's done. There's not much for him left to do, because this is probably what's up the events of this particular portion of the arc. And basically, I'm looking forward to see what happens next. But since next week, we're going to finish up Chapter 48, and probably go straight to Chapter 49, and potentially Chapter 50. Yep. Oh, in case you're curious, though, the arc itself officially wrapped up with Chapter 57. So, because they finished up adapting, because you might think, oh, they went to 47 today, like yesterday actually. They had 10 chapters, more like 9.5 chapters left to go. Actually, it's more like 8.5 chapters left to go for this whole arc. So, my guess is we're not going to get this arc last much longer. I'd say probably about 10 more episodes, I'd say. I mean, I'd be surprised if they have this arc stretch out for the rest of the year. That would be something. But here's a question, though. What's next for the series once they finish adapting this arc? Because I highly doubt they're going to go straight to the very next arc of the series, which takes place sometime afterwards. I would probably think they probably would tell some original content in there in order to, like, give the manga a little more time to basically just release more content. I would not be surprised at that, because up until very recently, we haven't had any, like, that much of, like, adaptation of manga. Like, before this arc, and of course this arc came after the AO arc, and before that arc happened, we had a good, like, a lot of episodes between the Meiji Madness arc and, of course, the stuff going on here. Like, a long stretch of anime, like, a brief stretch of anime original episodes. So my guess is we're going to get some anime original content right after this arc wraps up. A full year is worth, mind you, probably. Yep. So yeah, that's it for Sick Love You. Stay tuned for more Super Sentai coming soon. Okay? See you next video. Bye.